Hello guys, good evening. How are you doing? Sorry, I was just connecting to the internet, that's why I got delayed by 3-4 minutes. Okay, hi guys, how are Renuka, Shubham, Naveen, Navyanka, Kritika, Ratna Kumari, AJ? Kritika, class is starting now. Kirtika, AJ, Jagdeep, Charu, Dimple, Chidesh, Ajay, Johan, Kavita, Arth, Sinduja, hello, good evening, George. Alright guys, so today would be the last day of our discussion because other faculty also have to take. So whatever is possible, we have tried to do it to the best of our ability. So today, yesterday we did in detail IBC amendment and we also did arbitration because it was, time was not there. So as far as the syllabus is concerned, correct, today what we'll be doing is we will be doing PMLA, friends, correct? Pamela Anderson, all that, don't tell. PMLA, right? PMLA will be doing, and then we will also be doing very, very important FCRA, which comes for 6 marks. This also comes for 4 to 6 marks. And we'll quickly go through the SEBI LODR regulations, which are also important. Around 4 marks will come. So today we'll be trying to finish around 15 to 16 marks of the syllabus. Okay? Yes. Increase the volume. It's increased only, Noda. Yes. Okay? So first law is Pamela law, that is PMLA, Prevention of Money Laundering Act, is what we are going to discuss, very, very important. So let's see how to do it. Okay guys, okay, so let's do it. Prevention of Money Laundering Act. Yes, what do you mean by money laundering? What do you understand by the term launder? This picture will help us understand very clearly everything about money laundering. So if you see, the word launder was actually derived from the word laundering. I'm not kidding. The word launder came from the word laundering itself. So basically it is converting, you would have heard many things, no? Black money, white money, all that. So what is this particular thing then? Is it black money, white money, or illegal money? What's the difference? Black money is something which, you know, on which tax has not been paid. It may have a legal character, it may not have a legal character, right? That is black money. So someone is telling that please take FCRA class last because it's new syllabus only. Okay, we'll do that. Mayank, I started watching Ozark after watching your PMLA. Thank you for the recommendation. That's an amazing show, man, Ozark, especially the third season. Brilliant. First two seasons are fine, but third season is mind-blowing. That recently came out, Jason Bateman and all that. Third season came out recently. Okay, so some practical case studies, all that we need to see. First, what is this money laundering? Black money is something, money on which you have not paid tax. Illegal money, on the other hand, is of course money which is taken from illegal means. There is something called terror funding, correct? So if you see our parliament attack in 2001, Afzal Guru and all were indicted. But if you see, they came in with AK-47 guns. How will they get so much? And now recent 26/11, if you see, Ajmal Kasab was brandishing a AK-47 gun and just killing them as if it was some PUBG game. How will they get so much money? It is obviously through terror funding. So terror funding is one dangerous thing that we need to look into now. And this part of money laundering will help that terror funding. So there are complex layers. I mean, more into that later, since it's revision, I cannot get into it. But yes, in the olden days, you know this Al Capone, there was one Don called Al Capone. This, if you are into English movies, or there is one movie called Capone, Al Capone, he was the greatest Don at that time. So, right, so this Al Capone was one guy who used to, he didn't know what to do with the money, how to convert it into white money. So he actually opened his laundromats, laundromats, this laundry, and where he used to wash the money. The entire process is called washing. It doesn't mean he'll put it in the washing machine and wash, no. That is something tainted money, conversion of tainted money to untainted money is called as, you know, money laundering. Something which is tainted, maybe through illegality or anything, extortion, and converting that is this. So they'll open laundromat, and if you are into English shows and all that, you should watch this called Breaking Bad. It is rated as one of the best shows of all time. So there you'll show, they'll show that fellow opens eventually a laundromat, he'll open a car wash and all those things. So laundry is what we need to see, right? So if you see, this is what we need to understand, friends, that laundering money, how does it work practically? So there are three, methods of working on it. One is called placement, right? Then layering, and finally integration. This was one of the MCQs also in the exam. The various steps of money laundering is placement, layer, integration. Placement, something else they had given, then, you know, integrity, then, you know, something called teaming and lading, all that, some nonsense terms they had given in one of the MCQs. So answer is very simple, placement, layering and integration. This they had asked in paper 4 also, paper 6 also, 6D. So this PMLA, so good thing about the economic law elective is that if you read this properly, no, IBC, FEMA and PAMELA, PMLA, same three chapters are also there in 6D, but more in depth. Obviously there we can't do the surface level study, there we have to go to clause by clause analysis. So that is the scene. So if you see placement, layering and integration. So placement is very simple, where this is the first step where I have lot of black money with me. So slowly small deposits I will put in the bank. During the November 1st 2016, our honorable prime minister said, Mitro, kal se what gone 1000 rupees damar and 500 rupees also gone for 12 o'clock onwards. No, so if you see November 1st 2016 to December 31st 2016, around 30,000 crore money was laundered through various sham companies. True story. The sham companies, this I do it in my regular batch, for my regular batch students will know, we had explained the concept of dormant company, then linked it to 164, so you will understand. Anyway, now there's no time, guys, leave it. So if you see, those sham companies, they had done it. So the thing is that, how did they do it? Small deposits, 1000, 2000, each person deposited 5000, 10,000, like that. So that is called placement. Then layering is slowly converting that into legitimate businesses. Slowly trying to, you know, buying, opening laundromats and all that. Then this, when you open laundromats, anyway, laundromats and all that, and car wash, actually it's a legal business, car wash will actually happen. Then they will also put this other money, that is black money, illegal money, through laundromats. So in the day, only some 15 cars would have washed. But I will tell 100 cars came and washed, and I'll give bill also. So basically this conversion of black money into white. Conversion of black money is still okay, but conversion of tainted money, I'm just saying, when I say still okay, it's not okay. But the thing is, at least that is better compared to the other part where you use illegal money and then have these fronts. So Al Capone was one guy who had all these fronts way, you know, long time ago. So that is one thing that really has to be stopped. So that part has to be stopped. That is the reason why we have all these things. Okay. So now let us go into the practical aspect of money laundering, just to understand how money laundering works. But for that, we have to understand the, you know, definition first. Definition first. See, some parts of the definition has been amended, which I'm not seeing in the RTP, but still I'm going to tell you, because you never know, institute, one thing you should never trust, because what they have not given only, they'll give in the exam. So it's not going to confuse you in any way, it's just an addition. So don't worry, that also you need to write in the examination, all right? So what they have defined, it's a process or an activity. Mind you, this definition changed on 1st August 2018. Amended, and 100% it will apply in July 2020. RTP, it is missing, but it's okay. You can add this particular point also, no issue, because it is not any complete change in the definition, it is a mere addition. process or activity where the proceeds of crime, you have to take the proceeds of crime, has been concealed, that it is resulted in concealment of property, possession of property, acquisition or use of property. So the proceeds of crime has been utilized in buying a property, and that property has been concealed, used, acquired, whatever the case may be. And the best part is, I am projecting it or claiming it to be untainted. Untainted means absolutely clean. So using the proceeds of crime, I am acquiring a property and showing as if there is no problem with that particular thing, right? So that is a scene. So then in what? In property. Property or value of property, that's what it says. Now let us try to understand, and it can either be derived or obtained in India or abroad by any person through any criminal activity related to a scheduled offense. Now the crux of PMLA is very, very simple. It should be a scheduled offense. Scheduled offense is part A, part B and part C. It includes generally your Indian Penal Code offenses, Criminal Procedure Code, and of course your customs and all those things. So those offenses A, B, C. So it will carry those offenses, scheduled offense only, not any other thing. So if I evade tax, if you think about it, that income tax offenses are not covered under scheduled offense. So that will not come under PMLA. But if you use the proceeds of crime into various other activities, then it will involve proceeds of, it will involve PMLA. Now, if you see this particular case, I will explain quickly. This is about our VG Siddhartha Cafe Coffee Day case. Now this was one of the videos which actually clicked for me. I had just out of my sheer interest analyzed this and I had put it up, and that point of time, I think last year, it had fetched a lot of comments and views and all that. So it's very close to my heart, because if people came to know in the market that there is this fellow called PJ, Nervous Jai Kumar, it was because of this video, because of this analytical video that I had posted. So I'm extremely, this is very close to my heart, this particular video, because it got me, you know, some amount of recognition where people say, okay, this fellow has analyzed this particular case. So that's a 50 minute in detail analysis of this. Now I cannot do all that, quickly we'll finish up, okay? Yes. Yes, Alvin has told that, you know, PMLA and CCD and all you have watched. Thank you, man. And also analysis. I'll be doing more analytical videos. Because law, friends, is not to be studied from just an examination point of view. We all, tomorrow you all will become lawmakers maybe, and of course interpreters of law. So tomorrow when people come to you and ask, sir, how to interpret this, you should be in a position to do it. So please don't study only for the heck of clearing the exam. Please go much beyond it, because in the end that will also help you a lot. Okay, so let's see. So very simple, guys. SM Krishna was there. He was a previous chief minister of our state, Karnataka. I'm from Bangalore, so from Karnataka this person was there. His protege, his very, very close associate, was DK Shivkumar. Now DK Shivkumar is one guy who has declared assets worth of 700 crore. Mind you, declared assets. He has a mall in Dubai, housing Birmingham, 125 flat in Mumbai. How many do you have? He has 125 flats in Mumbai, correct? That's the thing. So crazy. Yes. So what happened was this. DK Shivkumar was very close to SM Krishna, and DK Shivkumar's daughter was raided. So she was just a college kid and she had properties worth some 100 crore. She also didn't know how it came. Correct? So then the income tax department raided. So she had a company called Messar Soul Space and all those things. When income tax department raided, just by fluke, when income tax department raided, so you see 20 crore was what? 20 crore amount was given by CCD through various layers of investment companies and subsidiaries. So this was a blatant violation of 186(1) of Companies Act layers, and also it was a violation of 2 clause 87 of Companies Act subsidiary companies. So one holding company should have only two subsidiary companies. So this scene happened where through CCD, through Messar Soul Space, many layers. So by chance, just by chance, they found out that Messar Soul Space has got from CCD. So what is the connection with CCD? Very simple. CCD was owned by V.G. Siddhartha, who happened to be S.M. Krishna's son-in-law. Right? V.G. Siddhartha was S.M. Krishna's son-in-law. This is the scene. So now what happened? Then they decided to probe into it further. So what did they say there? Very simple. In CCD here, what they said, there was a concealed income of 650 crore. They probed into CCD now. Concealed income of 650 crore, not one, not two, 650 crore. And also unaccounted personal income of 362 crore. By whom? By V.G. Siddhartha. V.G. Siddhartha was known to be one of the philanthropic businessmen of Karnataka and India. So from modest beginnings, obviously his father was decently rich. He had a farm, he had a coffee estate in Chikmagalur region of Karnataka, coffee estate. So this guy was good, but he went to Mumbai and learned the tricks of the trade in terms of the stock exchanges. And at one point of time in the early 90s, he was minting some 2 lakh rupees per day using his brilliance in the stock market. But his true, once he went to Singapore, there's a place called Clark Quay and Boat Quay there. There by the, in 1997 or something. So he saw the people sitting by the pool, I mean by the river bay there, working on the computer, that big computer which was there before now. And then they were sipping coffee. So basically their internet was free and they just had to pay for the coffee. So he thought, why not do it in India? So he came to Bangalore. He took a loan from his dad and also somehow scrambled from all the money that he had earned, scrambled to put in around 1 crore rupees along with the loan, and he bought the first leased line in India. Leased line of internet in 95 was only given to the government and military, but he was the first private citizen of our country to buy the leased line. So using that leased line, he started this Cafe Coffee Day, where in Bangalore itself, there's a place called MG Road here. I mean, every city has MG Road, no? Mahatma Gandhi Road. Here also we have MG Road, the most happening road, they say. Nothing is happening now, full khali it is. Yesterday only I had gone there. So if you see, yeah. So basically there, he started this first ever Cafe Coffee Day, opened up all the, it was more like a, you know, your cyber cafe. Some 20 computers, they said, you aram se pay, sit here and pay for the coffee. Coffee charged one bomb. Now coffee you would have seen. Then slowly and steadily he built an empire across India, across the world also. That's how it happened. Okay. Now this guy, unfortunately, I mean, and he had given employment to over 50,000 people in Karnataka alone. So he was that kind of a guy. Or through CCD, various cafes across India, he had definitely given. So generally the national drink of India is chai, right? But he also made coffee on par with chai. So here, if there are many people from North India and all that, probably you may feel that what coffee and all is nothing. But honestly, in South India, especially in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and all that, coffee is like the staple drink, correct? Coffee is a staple drink. Kerala anyway runs on tea, and the whole of India runs on tea. Tea is the actual national drink of our country. But here, down south, we are coffee lovers, right? Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and all that, coffee lovers, hardcore coffee lovers, including me. So if you see, what happened was V.G. Siddhartha said that he brought this coffee, at least tried to bring it on par with this tea, and he spread the entire name across the country. He had amassed an empire, no doubt about it. Now the question is, what happened? So they figured out that all these things had happened, and D.K. Shivakumar had one transport company, Sharma Transport, one full two scam fellows are there in that. So they were indulging in lot of money laundering. So taking this money and all those things. Then one more employee was there, Dikshit. Dikshit was an employee, and the director finance of CCD also was involved. His name was Monish Gopinath. His brother was Rajneesh Gopinath. And they found out, the income tax sleuths found out that once they saw, they caught Rajneesh Gopinath in Singapore with 1 to 2 crore of hawala money. Now what is this hawala transaction? Anything, any money that has gone out of the country or coming into the country without going through the proper RBI channel is called hawala transaction. It may be legal, illegal, I mean the money can be of extortion money, whatever it is, but it is illegal to take it outside the country or bring it inside the country with without going through the RBI mechanism. So this was the scene. So they found 1 to 2 crore hawala transaction and lot of messages were there of hawala transaction directly putting this person on board there. VG Siddhartha was at the middle of all these things. This was the scene. So this is one part of it. Then of course this is one part. Then apart from that, friends, there was a company called Devadarshini Infotech Private Limited. It was a bogus company, no employees. The objects clause of the company said it is into computer peripherals. Computer peripherals, which had almost 15 crore loss in the balance sheet and all those things. Now there was one more company called Vaitarna Holding Private Limited, which was in a tax haven, Guyana. Guyana, it was a tax haven. Now this Vaitarna Holding Private Limited is a subsidiary of Vaitarna Timber Private Limited. This Timber Private Limited is an Indian company. Subsidiary company of that is called Holding Company. Amazing. Correct? That's the thing. There was one joke also, no? In CA exam, they'll ask this question. Correct? They'll ask this question. And a parrot sat on an elephant and the elephant died. Explain. 6 marks. CA student is like, what the hell is this question? Parrot sat on elephant and elephant died. How? So he's full, racks his brain and all that, then he'll write some crap and come. Then 2 months later, suggested answers will come. In suggested answers, they would have written, very simple. Assume elephant's name is parrot and parrot's name is elephant. Like that. Holding company is Vaitarna Timber. Subsidiary company name is Vaitarna Holding. Crazy. So if you see, that's the thing. Private, Guyana, tax haven. That's what happened. So the funds, the what happened was, this Vaitarna Holding Private Limited was selling timber to a company whose objective was computer peripherals. Really, really, you know, absurd. How is it that possible? Computer peripherals you are doing and this Vaitarna Holding Private Limited is selling timber. So all that also. So basically they are selling 1 crore worth of timber for 4 crores. So where is the money going? They are draining the money out of the Indian company to a tax haven. From here also they are laundering the money outside the country, which is a tax haven. And they had political connections. Father-in-law is a politician, right? I mean, he's still not proven that he did something, but what I'm saying is political clout is there. So they were going out like that. So if you see, this, all these things really happened that time. So it was difficult for them to figure out. Then, of course, apart from that, they also took money from a company called Ardiono Holdings, and they actually issued cumulative convertible debentures. So in the end, CCD issued CCD. So CCD, the fake copy day, issued cumulative convertible debentures. And eventually they took lot of money and converted that into shares. And Ardiono Holdings, there is nobody there in the company. It was again one more sham company created. Then through their contacts through the Lakshmi Vilas Bank, they gave a loan to the employees who in turn bought shares of CCD. Think about it. When CCD shares are going down, they ask their employees only to buy the shares of CCD to make it go up. This again resulted in market manipulation under SEBI. This was also a problem. After all these things happened, our income tax department said enough is enough. Income tax department said enough is enough, and they did what? They went and said they attached the Mindtree shares. So VG Siddhartha, I told this to you when discussing merger and amalgamation. The income tax department attached the Mindtree shares belonging to VG Siddhartha, which was around 20-22% he had. So VG Siddhartha was in a completely, you know, bad position. We had to repay the money. So he had no choice but to sell off those shares. Who did we sell it to? Remember, sold it to L&T. Sold it to L&T. Remember, I had connected that in merger amalgamation. He sold it for 3,600 crore. Not one, not two. 3,600 crore. 20-22% he had. So then they said, IT had attached this thing. So he said that they agreed only if all the loans were repaid. Tax had to be paid. Only 41 crore out of 362 crore had been paid. That's all. He said full tax you have to pay. And he attached the Cafe Coffee Day shares. Cafe Coffee Day shares are attached. So the income tax department agreed only if the, they said your own company, whatever shares you have, I am going to attach the shares of that company. So the thing is, you are the owner of something which you started on your own, and now you don't even hold shares of that company, somebody else has control. And the thing is, There were also deals where he would wanted to sell the entire Cafe Coffee Day brand to Coca-Cola. And there was one more Global Village Tech Park, Baghmane Tech Park in Bangalore, which he wanted to sell off. Talks were going on. And that time there was a power struggle in Karnataka between BJP and Congress. So that's why it's always that happens. That's why they always say it is Nataka in Karnataka. Now Natak obviously is your, you know, drama. Always drama happens between Congress and BJP here generally, and your one more party called JDS, Janata Dal. You might know because the main head of the JDS, Devegowda, was our India's Prime Minister for 11 months. So this general knowledge point you should know. So if you see this, what happened was here they said that boss, nothing can be done. They were pressurizing Vijay Siddhartha. There was a power struggle. If Congress had won that particular election, then they would brush this under the carpet. BJP had other skeletons to hide. So they would divert the attention to this Vijay Siddhartha, and they had a grudge against this guy, DK Shivkumar, DK Shivkumar, he had a grudge. So the thing is, now constantly was calling DK Shivkumar, and then DK Shivkumar was busy because of the power struggle. And the day Congress lost the trust vote on the floor of Karnataka government, Karnataka Assembly, that was the day he asked his driver to go on the banks of the river, on the top of the bridge, where he had crossed so many times. He had crossed so many bridges in life. And that day, he completely said, enough is enough. So I always tell dear friends, this was a man who was worth over easily 1,000 crores. Easily 1,000, 2,000, maybe 10,000. People say all assets put together around 10,000 crore. A man worth 1,000 crore, or let's say 10,000 crore, had to lay down his life by jumping. But he was an expert swimmer. So for you to just let go of everything and fall with a wife and kids and entire family, you are looking after 50,000 people, and even his father was on the deathbed. Think about the mental pressure that he was going through. That's why I always tell, you may have a lot of net worth, but the self-worth is more than net worth. So his self-worth was way more than net worth, and he realized that I completely diluted my self-worth all this while by indulging in this money laundering. This is money laundering, proceeds of crime. What he did was a crime, of course, hawala transaction, all these things were crimes. And after a person is dead, who will you punish? The case got closed, and DK Shivkumar was jailed by the Enforcement Directorate for a while, then he came back. Today he is a minister, is Aram Sai, you know, still continuing the same. So friends, these are the things that obviously happened. This is the gist of the entire discussion. So basically, it is so ironic that the dialogue of this coffee day itself is, a lot can happen over coffee. A lot did happen. A life was born and a business started, which became, you know, a household name in the whole of India. He opened branches across, and a lot can happen. Even the life, you know, was taken away by himself because he could not fathom the suddenness of everything, and also he could not understand the fact that how did he let his self-worth go way less than his net worth, and eventually he decided that I cannot face all these things. So ultimately, friends, it's not at all about the money. We all may crib feeling that we don't have money and all those things. Honestly, it's not at all about money. Money will come and we will survive, but it's about the self-worth that we have is what is needed. There's one little spiritual point in between. It is needed to understand that our future, what is the objective? Is it to earn a lot of money, or is it to earn a lot of respect? So in my opinion, that is the only thing that is really needed, friends, than anything else. So money will come, but what really sticks by, what really stands, is the self-worth that a person has, right? Cool. So next, this is about money laundering basics. Now moving on to the definitions and all those things. So overall idea, if you get now, then it will become very easy. Let's see. So what does it say, money laundering? It's a process or activity where proceeds of crime that you have, where I am going to buy the property using the proceeds of crime. Let us say my father, let's say, is one Don. He's not, assume he's a Don. So he has lot of ill-gotten wealth. So using that money, he'll gift me a car, one property. Is that property? Yes. How did the property, one car, I am using it, I have no clue what my dad does. I'm using the car bought by my dad. Now, is the car, I'm using the car daily, correct? I'm using the car daily. Is that proceeds of crime is the question. Is that proceeds of crime? If I just buy a car, is it proceeds of crime? Or let's say I give that car, my dad buys a fleet of cars, assume. He buys a fleet of cars. He buys some 10, 20 luxury cars. And he gifts it to me because I have started a business of renting out these luxury cars. Now the question was, is just gifting those luxury cars proceeds of crime? Or but me doing business, using that cars and earning some money, is that also proceeds of crime? A very, very important question was raised. Now this particular amendment deals with that, correct? This particular deals with that. Somebody is asking, how do you analyze the information? Which information? This one. So this requires a lot of practice, lot of reading, lot of interconnection and knowledge of these laws. PMLA, then your Companies Act, all that if you have. So you will be in a position to analyze. So you will also be able to analyze, give it some time. So now it's just, you're just studying for the exam. So one thing, friends, now after clearing the examination, I would strongly suggest you buy lectures of the faculty that you like and you sit and around and listen to it. But for that, discipline should be there. Personally, I attended direct tax classes, indirect tax classes after clearing also. That time, no, there is no pressure. You can analyze the law for the beauty of law. Because when I cleared my exam and I cleared the CA and then sat in the class, then I'm seeing left, right, all of them are just fixated on the exam. The teacher is telling, this is important. Suddenly, full underline, highlighter, V, important, all that. We are only fixated on the examination. But I was looking at them and like, okay, I was also like this only 2 months ago, correct? No, 3 months ago, I was only like this. But after clearing the exam, no, your only concentrate will be on the on gaining that knowledge. That time, all these connections will come. So you can analyze it like that later. So it's our entire obsession. I can assure you, out of 60-70 people are here, how many of you are here only for the knowledge? I can assure you, maybe not even one. It's absolutely fine. You are only here because of the examination. Correct? Now if I now put one dialogue, all the people have cleared, please come, I'll do a knowledge sharing thing of something. Many people, most, even you will not come. Even I wouldn't have come. That's what I'm trying to tell. Hey, it's there now, we'll see later. It'll anyway be there, we'll see later. So, but now you're actually sitting down here and listening to the class only because you have an examination to write. That's the hard fact of life. Connection and all, we'll see later, man. Now let's clear the exam. That's a good thought. But what I'm saying is, now you cannot analyze. Once you clear, you have that freedom of mind, then you have to bring that self-discipline. It's not easy to sit in class for 180 hours after clearing the exam when you don't have a goal. But if the goal is to learn how to do all these things or understand, analyze, you can do that. Okay? Yes. Saranya asking how much I got in law. Well, I'll be honestly telling you that in CA Inter, I got 42. I'm not joking. This is my mistake only because of overconfidence. I did not write the answer. In auditing, I wrote the answer. So I actually got in auditing same IPCC 77 because I was scared of auditing. I was writing the answers everywhere. 77 I got. Law, I got 42. Overconfidence. In CA final, I got both. I got 60 plus. I don't remember the marks, guys. When 2012, 8 years ago, I passed. I don't remember the marks. But yes, what I'm trying to tell is this was overconfidence that was a slap on my face saying that, boss, you think you know law and all that. That time I didn't know what is Bayer Act and all those things, honestly. So when I was seeing this, I was like, what the hell is this? 42 because of overconfidence, because I didn't know Bayer Act. I didn't know concept of Bayer Act methodology. Some smallest textbook I took, flipping. That is when I realized that this is not how you should study law. So after IPCC, first thing that I got from my stipend, I still remember, I bought a Bayer Act, which I still have. I don't know if I have it here. I still have that Bayer Act, fully, completely battered now it is. 1956 Bayer Act it is. I still got that and studied it clause by clause, line by line. That is because of this, a slap on my face, 42, just pass. This is an IPCC. But in final, I was fine. Yes, so if you see there, come back. So untainted property, I'm projecting or claiming it to be untainted, though it is tainted. That is the thing. Very, very interesting to know, it should be a criminal activity relating to a scheduled offence. And scheduled offence is given in part A, part B, part C. Okay? And part B, value must be minimum 1 crore. Part B, the offence value must be minimum 1 crore. This is the scene. And I told you guys, my father gifted me a fleet of cars. My father gifted a fleet of cars to me. And I'm using it in my business and hiring, renting it out. Is that also proceeds of crime? Now this amendment will help us understand. Property not only derived or obtained as a result of criminal activity, and also that is what? Enjoying the proceeds of crime also, continuing activity. Enjoying the proceeds of crime, that is continuing activity also. A continuing activity also is called as what? Money laundering. So if my dad gives me a fleet of cars, not only using them, in the fact that he got the car, money laundering. The fact that I'm using the car and enjoying it is also money laundering. That is the dangerous amendment. It's just an addition to what you already know. This is an addition. This is nothing has changed. Just an addition. Okay. So that is what you need to understand. Now, what is property and asset? Something which is movable, immovable, tangible, intangible, deeds and instrument. Right. Corporeal, incorporeal. What is corporeal? Corporeal means something which is living. So, if you see again, if you keep on reading the newspapers, right, you will also understand what are these things and all that. Let me just show you why I am showing you all these things. Okay, let's see. This is here only, it's there. Yeah, check out. So the enforcement director in this case attached chimpanzees, marmoset under the Money Laundering Act, because you know Wildlife Protection Act also is part of the scheduled offence. If you poach the animals, etc., that also is a scheduled offence. So if you, one poacher here had, what do you say, stolen chimpanzees, marmosets, and actually he was transporting it to various places. Now under money laundering, they also attach that particular thing, saying that enforcement directorate said this is a corporeal body, means living thing. Since it is corporeal, they attach that particular chimpanzees also. So think about it. That is the example of what, friends? Corporeal. Same question came in November 19 new syllabus. Yes. So that's why I'm saying we should understand all that. Don't ignore any of those things. So you see, this is called corporeal. Correct? So that's why we need to understand corporeal. Corporeal means living. Okay? Now, that is one part. So what they ask in our exam? No, they'll ask you the definition of money laundering. What is it? Process or activity? Then remember, mind mapping, proceeds of crime and with respect to property. What of property? Concealment of property, possession, acquisition, use. Whether derived or obtained directly or indirectly in India, or also value of the property can be in India or abroad, equivalent value. For example, if I want to attach the property of Vijay Mallya, his house in UK, I cannot touch that house. So what will I do? I will take something which is equivalent to that in India only. I can attach. So if there's a video where he had a fleet of luxury cars, guys, he had some 20 luxury cars. Because he ran away, they attached those luxury cars. So there was a video in here in Bangalore, he had this UB City. So from UB City, from his residence, some 20 luxury cars coming out. So they have a video where they attach that also. So equivalent in India is what you need to see. Recently, last month, huge drug transporting group got caught. Yes, transporting drugs, anything. That is the most dangerous thing in money laundering, anything related to psychotropic drug. You know, narcotics and psychotropic drug activities. You would have watched the movie, no? The series Narcos and all that. Correct? Pablo Escobar. So all those things, if you do, gone. And the most dangerous thing in money laundering, one second, let me change the battery quickly. Yeah. So the most important thing in money laundering is, I mean, the most dangerous offense would be Narcotic and Psychotropic Substances Act, that one. If you get caught in that, gone. So that is the scene. Okay, very simple. So if you see, yeah, so that is the the property derived either in India or even equivalent in India. If it's abroad, property, I know it's abroad, equivalent in India I can use. That is the scene. That is one question. Then they'll ask you, these are all examination questions, whatever I'm discussing. Next question they'll ask you, what do you mean by payment system? Payment system means what? Anything that enables the payer, payee, beneficiary relationship. Payment system can be what? Debit card, credit card, smart card, money transfer. So basically the banks should analyze the payment system very, very carefully. They should see how much money is going in, coming out and all those things. So that is the payment system. So 2 marks they had asked you, what do you mean by payment system? So this is for the banks to check. Financial institutions should always ensure that debit card, credit card, smart card, money transfer, etc. are well within the, you know, RBI guidelines. Now the most important thing is the punishment. Correct? Punishment. What is this punishment? Check out. Part 2. If I fall under para 2 of part A, not part 2, sorry, para 2 of part A, that is my, I told you, no, Narcos, Escobar, Pablo Escobar scene this is. Those of you who watched Narcos will come to know. Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act. If you come under that, friends, dangerous. 3 years to 10 years rigorous imprisonment. Rigorous means what? They will make you work there, slog. Normal simple imprisonment is you will be in jail, you will be given time to go out, exercise and all those things. Rigorous means you will be made to work there 8 hours a day. Rigorous imprisonment. And when I haven't written or, it is and. So it is a non-compoundable offense. You cannot escape punishment at all. And fine. Any limit fine. Any amount they can do it. Okay. In other cases, there is rigorous imprisonment, 3 years to 7 years. Here, if you see, it's 3 years to 10 years. Here it is 3 years to 7 years and any limit. So technically here, extra 3 years is given. So if you are caught under PMLA by supplying some drugs and all that, then gone. That is the scene. You would have seen many things. Let me show you. Maybe it's there here. You would have seen many cases like that where... If I find it here, I'll show you. Otherwise, see this guy, man trying to smuggle cocaine. Vinder is wig. Hero had put his wig here like this, and then under the wig he has this takla fellow. Here one wig is there, and under the wig is trying to smuggle cocaine. How much cocaine? Cocaine, if you get caught, dangerous. 24 lakh worth of cocaine at Barcelona airport, like that. Correct? So all these things dangerous, like that. So that is called narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances. So even anything that is, you know, against the Wildlife Protection Act, your Veerappan, there was a guy called Forest Brigand Veerappan, he was smuggling, he was killing elephants and all that and smuggling. Even today in Assam, there is this Kaziranga Wildlife Sanctuary where the one-horned rhinoceros is there. They just kill the animal and cut off the entire thing, not cut off the horn, because that horn ivory is worth a lot of money. So these are the things, all these are protected by the Wildlife Protection Act. But still our laws are very old and has to be revamped. But technically these are all criminal offenses covered under PMLA. So PMLA, friends, is not a civil law. PMLA is a criminal law. Okay. So if you get caught under that, gone. That's the thing. So if you see, that's now very fancy question they ask in the exam is, what are the duties of the reporting entities? Means who are reporting entities? Banks, financial institutions, stock broker. I go to a stockbroker and tell him, boss, look, I have suddenly got some 10 lakh rupee money. I want to invest in that. He should get a doubt. He'll see your income tax return. You have never filed a return in your life. Suddenly you got 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs to invest. How? So immediately he should obviously inform the authorities. Similarly, banks, financial institutions, this is the first layer of the money laundering is placement, right? So placement level itself, suddenly you are always getting 10,000, 20,000 in your account. Suddenly some 5 lakhs comes. How? But it happened to me. I had a Canara Bank account, and you know our stipend was some 1,500, 2,000 rupees. So I had 24 brilliant entries in my account every year. ₹2,000 credit, next day only debit, that's it, 24 entries. What CA article means, same thing, no, correct? CA articles, you know, if the stipend is increasing, which tense is it? Present tense, past tense, it's called future impossible tense, it can never happen, correct, no? So if you see that like that, suddenly my dad had taken one life insurance policy in my name and had got matured and I got some ₹30,000. I got a call from the anti-money laundering wing of Canara Bank. They said, sir, what, you have some, suddenly 30,000 came, how? I said, boss, I know 22,000 I'm earning, but that is 20,000 is the thing. I gave him them all the details. So banks will have their own anti-money laundering wing. So what are their duties? They ask in the examination, right? So if you see, yes, Shivaji movie, correct. Shivaji movie, they have seen all that, shown all that money laundering. Yes, last, in the end, he'll come, no, Mottai Boss, right? That movie, superb movie it is. Yes, so if you see, record of transaction, I should give, to whom? Correct, I should give it to all these, the authorities, including BO and SBO. This is a section 89 and 90. I had explained it, I think, Rendezvous Sports Private Limited. When I was explaining 219 section, I explained this already. It's there in the RPL. Check it out. So there I also linked it to the Shashi Tharoor, Rendezvous Sports Private Limited, right? So SBO. Who is the man behind the show? Shashi Tharoor, in that example. So section 89 and 90 is what I need to see, including beneficial owner and significant beneficial owner. So from the date of transaction, for around 5 years, they should have access to all information. Basically, from the date of transaction, whatever, today if I suddenly ₹30,000 came, 5 years they have to keep that data and they have to try and investigate why the money came and all that. Even if the business relationship ends or account is closed, today I close Canara Bank account, still all my details should be kept for 5 years. All my details should be kept for 5 years. So who can call the information? That is the director of the FIU, Financial Intelligence Unit, correct? Or the Enforcement Directorate. This FIU regulates all the banks, financial institutions and all those things, correct? They will talk hand in hand with ED. ED is Enforcement Directorate. Enforcement Directorate. So FIU India will talk to ED, and then FIU is the regulator for all these, what do you say, banks, financial institutions and all these things, correct? So there is this Financial Action Task Force, FATF also. This is the task force in India, FIU, Financial Intelligence Unit of India. So that director has the right. He will also work with one more department under the criminal wing of PMLA called Enforcement Directorate. You would have seen ED summons Vijay Mallya, ED is after Vijay Mallya, like that. So all these things you will see. So the reporting entity, those banks, should furnish the information and obviously maintain the confidentiality of all these things. 5 years. This they'll ask you 4 marks question. What are the, this is only for paper 4, I'm not talking about paper 60. Paper 60, they'll ask many interconnected and in-depth questions. Paper 4, these questions are already come. 4 marks, they've asked you definition of proceeds of crime. Then they've asked you, what do you mean by payment system, 2 marks. Then this one, what is the punishment under this PMLA? They'll give a case study sort of a thing. Then this one, what are the duties of the reporting entities? Then what should the director do, director of FIU? What should the director do? Correct, the director of the Financial Intelligence Unit of India will inquire whether there is cooperation from the, will inquire into the dealings and ask for cooperation from the reporting entity. If there is no cooperation of the reporting entity, he will also check the audited financial statements. There is no cooperation, first he will issue a warning. First he will issue a warning. Then he will direct him to comply with the provisions. First I'll issue a warning. Second is what? Direct the to comply with the provisions. Yes. Then the director of the FIU will also direct them to send the reports. All the reports that he wants has to be sent. Yes, of course, the amendment with respect to section 11 is about the Aadhaar card. Now they also have to collect the Aadhaar card of the people, all the banks. KYC, you also need to take Aadhaar card, because PAN card could be sort of duplicated. I only had 3 PAN cards, I remember at one point of time. I had applied one, my dad had applied for me, my uncle also applied for me. So at one point of time, I had 3 cards. Then I could choose, I chose one fancy number, whatever I wanted. Then discarded the 2 and lodged a complaint, surrendered it to the income tax department. So PAN card was actually an identification card given by the department and by the government. But that doesn't seem to, you know, serve the purpose. That's why we have the Aadhaar card. So Aadhaar card linking is also, now that's there in the RTP, you can go through. These are all small, small changes. Now, penalty for a director if he doesn't follow. For a director and employee, it is 10,000 rupees to 1 lakh rupees. 10,000 rupees to 1 lakh for each failure. For each failure, it is 10,000 rupees to 1 lakh. Mind you, there is no civil or other criminal liability for not furnishing information. Though PMLA is a criminal law, this is one fine that they will have to pay. It is no criminal liability will be there against the ones for not disclosing the details and all those things. This is a 4-mark question again. What are the role of the director FIU and what are the duties or what are the things that the director FIU can order? So these things you have to write. Warning, direct, to comply with the reports, direct to send the reports and all these things. Got it? That is regarding that. Now, the most important thing, dear friends, is the adjudication. Very, very important is the adjudication part. So I've tried to make it easy with all these things. This is the most important thing, the adjudication. So couple of sections is what we need to see for the adjudication part of it. What happened to this? Yeah. So adjudication is the most, looks complicated, but trust me, it is not complicated. Okay. So let's see. Now, right. First, let us understand the concept of provisional attachment. Right? Let us understand the concept of provisional attachment. What it is, provisional attachment. If the officer concerned, right? If the officer concerned, material in his possession means what? He should have evidence. Material in his possession, has reason to believe, means what? Along with evidence, he should be reasonably convinced that any person is having, possessing what? Proceeds of crime. So with the material in his possession, should be reasonably convinced that what he has is proceeds of crime. And he will think that it is likely to be concealed or transferred in a way in going forward. If I don't seize it now, he feels, if I don't seize the property now, I also know that, for example, VG Siddhartha, income tax department already had eyes. So now the enforcement director also came, directorate came and said, I know that all these properties are there, I should attach. Mindtree shares are attached just like that. What if he had sold it immediately before attachment, correct? If it is likely to be concealed, hidden or transferred in order to frustrate confiscation, means what? In future, if I want to attach that and also make it my own, here it's the government, then this fellow will try to do it now. So with proper evidence and reasons to believe, I should be convinced that the proceeds of crime are there and this fellow is using the proceeds of crime, car or it can be some other company, it can be shares, whatever, proceeds of crime can be anything. I would have bought shares using some ill-gotten wealth, right? So now in that case, what I should do? But in writing, I should file a report, right? Obviously, you can't file a report orally. Writing, file a report and give it to the magistrate, the normal magistrate, judicial magistrate, who will take cognizance, who will take it on record and say, yes, this is what it is. This is one part of it. On the other hand, section 17 and 18 are parallel provisions. Section 17 and 18 are parallel provisions. While checking some documents, some other documents they come to know and then they figure out that this is maybe potential money laundering. That's what happened in our Vijay Siddhartha case, they some random politician DK Shivakumar, to their house they went, to their daughter they were checking. They were checking the documents of the daughter, then they came to know Coffee Day also has given. Then what happened? Then they seized those records, that is this part, 17 and 18 is different. 17, 18 is different, this is different, but under both the cases, I will give it to the magistrate who will take cognizance of the same. And then the director of the enforcement directorate or the deputy director authorized by the director is empowered by this entire order. They will order provisional attachment. Provisional means temporary. Temporary. Frustrate confiscation means what? If I do not attach it today, tomorrow he will, you know, sell the property to somebody else. So tomorrow if I have to attach the property and eventually make it the government's property, that's the difference between seizure and confiscation. Seizure is what? Transfer of possession. Confiscation is transfer of ownership. So if I don't take possession today, tomorrow I will not be able to take ownership because I know this fellow has committed the crime here. Correct? That's the thing. So frustrate, these are all the keywords taken from the BEAR Act. It has to be written like that in the exam if you want out of out in PMLA. PMLA and all is high scoring. So today I am discussing almost 15-16 marks all put together. So provisional copy, provisional attachment, temporary. It is temporary attachment. Now, if I attach it under this, friends, it will not affect the right of the interest holders in the property. Means what? I am attaching it. I am not taking it into my own record. I am just attaching it saying that you can use it, sir. You can use this car. But please don't go anywhere outside India and all or outside the state. This is, I am putting a GPS device also. I will be tracking it. You can use it. I have no problem. That is called provisional attachment. Got it? Provisional attachment. I have an eye. I know this car, you suddenly, your income statement shows 10 lakh rupees per annum salary. And this is a car worth 1.2 crore. How did you get this money? So it's okay, no problem. I know because you may probably sell this and all that. I don't know. So I put a tracking device, no problem, but I am going to provisionally attach it, right? That is called provisional attachment. Then, now this is filed with the AA, adjudicating authority. Adjudicating authority in PMLA is appointed by the central government, correct? Appointed by central government. And also the adjudicating authority will have a chairperson with two members. Chairperson with two members. Now what it means is, 180 days you can seize, provisionally seize, mind you, provisionally seize. 180 days. 180 days you can seize the particular document. Correct? That's the thing. So document or asset, whatever it is, 180 days is what you have. This 180 days you saw somewhere else, where? Inspection and investigation, remember, 180 days. So 180 days, friends, you have time to provisionally attach. Now, the thing is, do you think the other fellow will keep quiet? In India, we have legal means. Other fellow will put a stay order against this. Stay order he'll put. So 180 days, and let's say the High Court has granted a stay order. That's called injunction. Not injection, injunction. So you can't come and touch my car. I will put a stay order. It is against personal liberty. I go to the High Court and bring about a stay order. So the thing is, stay order period also should be excluded from that 180. They say for 2 months you cannot touch the car. So it will be 180 plus 2 months. It's like that. Further period not exceeding 30 days from stay order also will be counted. Means counted in the exclusion. Means what? This is for court delays and all those things. The procedure of entire court granting the stay, then sending it to the person, all that will take time, na? So that 30 days is what they have taken into account. So let us say the court says for 2 months you cannot touch that. So it will be 2 months plus 30 days. Let's say 60 days. 60 days plus 30 days. 90 days. So then it is 180 days plus 90. So stay order can be 3 months also, 4 months also, 5 months also. So it's 5 months plus 30 will be excluded from 180. We excluded from 180, which means that much time you can actually provisionally attach the assets. Got it? Ajay Chandra, 180 days IBC. That is yes, correct. That is for CIRP, right? That is not, I am talking about seizure here. Seizure can be linked with inspection. Done. This is the scene. This is the scene of provisional, 4 marks question. Explain the concept of provisional attachment under PMLA. This you have to write. Now, can I make the provisional attachment into actual attachment where I take over the property. That is called proper seizure, correct? Proper seizure, correct? Will I take over the property is the question. So that question comes here, that's a different section. Correct? Now come back. If the AA, who is that adjudicating authority? If the AA, either because of seizure under 17 and 18, either due to seizure under 17 or 18 or provisional attachment under section 5. Either under seizure under 17 and 18 or provisional attachment under section 5. We have already seen 17-18 is what? I came for a different purpose, but in the course of it I found something, I can't let it go, I will seize it. That is 17 and 18. Section 5 is what I just told you now, provisional attachment, where likely to believe, I'll write a report in writing and all that, got it? Then, if I have reason to believe, the AA has reason to believe, where there is usage of property, which is provisionally attached, seized or frozen, right? AA is telling what? Seizure under 17 and 18, provisional attachment under section 5, that's fine. If I have reason to believe further that the usage of property which is provisionally attached, seized or frozen, which property? That car is provisionally attached, and there is also existence of proceeds of crime. I know now for sure, because with that, holding that in mind, I have done now my investigation, I know that is 100% proceeds of crime. Within 30 days, I should give one show cause notice to that particular person asking him the sources of his income or earnings. Tell me your earnings. How the hell did you buy 1.2 crore wala car when your income tax return shows 10 lakh rupees? It is absurd. Please tell me how is the question. And he will ask why it should not be confiscated. I am going to tell boss, if you are not going to give me that thing, I don't know. Why it should not be confiscated, you tell me. Then PONJ will happen. What is PONJ? Principles of natural justice. Principles of natural justice. Opportunity of being heard. Reasonable opportunity of being heard will happen. Then they will pass an order confirming saying what? Who will pass an order? The AA will pass an order saying what? That the property which was already provisionally attached will now actually be attached. If you read this section just like that, no, full you will be shaking, shivering. I am not kidding. It's very, very tricky. 17, 18 and all these sections, if you read, 5, 6 are very, very tricky. So this chart you remember, it will be imprinted in your mind. So I have taken a lot of time to, you know, properly structure this particular thing using the keywords, right? So you please follow this blindly, okay? I have done the work already for you. Just blindly follow the chart, okay? So will now be attached and shall continue. Will now be attached and so the one which was provisionally attached is telling boss, I'm now gonna attach it in real life. I'm gonna attach it. Okay? And then what happens after that? Then shall be attached for how long? Attached for how long? Here they say, during the entire course of investigation, I'm gonna attach it, not exceeding 365 days. This is the amendment dated 20th March 2019. This had not been asked in the examination. This is the previous set of amendments. Concentrate on that also. Don't go blindly by what the amendments came now. This was the previous set. This was applicable for November examination. Okay. That's the thing. So, not exceeding 365 days, or if there is any again seer amendment, stay order or stay period is excluded. Stay order or stay period is excluded. Okay. So, how long will I keep this particular actual attachment? How long will I keep this attachment? During the period of investigation, not exceeding 365 days. Amendment is around 20th March says stay period also excluded. Or if any proceeding is pending against that particular asset or a particular case, whether in India or abroad, till that proceeding is pending, you can seize. In inspection investigation, it was 180 plus 180. Here they are saying during the full course of investigation, you can keep, not exceeding 365 days, mind you. Stay order and all you exclude, stay period and all exclude, and or also the proceeding is pending, till the proceeding is actually pending, till it is decided, then you also need to keep in mind here. That is the scene. Right? So that is what they are trying to tell. Right? 365 days. Now, after this, guys, while during the course of this particular thing, the director will take the possession. Provisional attachment may, there is no transfer of possession. The fellow will still, you know, use the property, no tension. But the moment the provisional attachment is converted to actual attachment, who will take possession of the same? Director, the director, which director? Not board of director. This director is what? Director of Enforcement Directorate, ED. ED will take possession. Automatically, the case will be transferred to a special court. Special court is some same like a court, only for a special purpose. A special court, there if the it is not proven, if it is not proven that it is money laundering, immediately it is released, issue is closed. Issue is closed. But if the property is used for money laundering, then what happens? First it was provisional attachment, then it became attachment, now it became confiscation in favor of the central government. And once it is confiscated by CG, if that property was given as a security and all to some bank, etc., CG and all will not repay it. It says, boss, it is now the moment it comes from attachment to confiscation, the property becomes free from all encumbrances. So all the rights attached, all the charge attached to that particular property will be delinked, and the pure property will come into the central government. Got it? That's the scene. However, one more amendment has come. If the special court can also direct the CG to restore to any person in good faith any legitimate interest. I don't know anything about this, sir. I am a bona fide lender. That fellow told, please give me loan. I asked how much you want. That fellow told, 20 lakhs I want. And that fellow said, you please take this car as security, sir. I got this car, but now liquidity crunch, corona and all that. Please give me 20 lakhs loan. I will repay it properly. And what did I take in return? I took that property as a encumbrance. So here I told you free from encumbrance. Here it's a minor exception. There they say special court can ask the CG to restore to the person, me, in good faith, who has legitimate interest in the property. I have a valid charge against that particular property and I have suffered a loss because of it, and I am not at all involved in the money laundering. I had no clue about it, sir. I am sorry. He just told me that is my car. He showed me the property, the actual ownership title deed he showed me. I gave him 20 lakh loan. He gave me a security against that. So please, I beg of you. I know you have told free from encumbrance, but I beg of you, please give me something. There is an amendment. Special court can tell the CG, and the special court can consider the claim during the trial. This is a small amendment. Consider that thing in the trial. So in the trial only they can say, okay, this fellow is there now, okay, you pay him something. Something like that they can consider is what I am trying to tell. This is the full process of which one, guys? Provisional attachment. Nothing to see here. What is this? Everything to see, man. Right? One second. So that is the full case of which one? That is the full case of provisional attachment. Where did it go? Correct? That's the same. Full scene of provisional attachment. Got it? That is regarding adjudication. Very, very important. Then finally, how will I arrest that person and all? First, arrest order will be passed by who all? Director, that is ED, Deputy Director, Assistant Director, or any person authorized by the central government. They will obviously arrest the person within 24 hours. These are Chidambaram, Lungi Man, correct? Superman is there, Spider-Man is there, our fellow is Lungi Man. So Lungi Man, they, Aram Say, sat inside his house only. You know, do whatever you want, I'll not come. So the CBI fellows, ED fellows had to scale the wall. He had to climb the wall using ladder, jump and arrest him in the INX media case. Right? That's what happened. So if you see, AA is adjudicating authority, special court is different. Both are different. So within 24 hours, they will produce it to whom? They will produce it before the special court. That's what happened to our Lungi Man. Lungi Man was produced to the special court within 24 hours. Or to judicial magistrate or metropolitan magistrate. Right? That is the scene. As far as appeal is concerned, appeal, the AA, correct? AA, that is adjudicating authority, or the director can pass an order. Within 45 days of the order, the aggrieved person or the director can file an appeal to the appellate tribunal. Correct? I can go beyond 45 days also, but I have to follow the principles of natural justice. And this appellate tribunal also is within 6 months, they have to dispose of the appeal. Beyond 60 days, within 60 days, I have to can file an appeal to the High Court. Beyond 60 days also is possible if it is bona fide. We studied this and went, they asked something else in the exam. They said appellate tribunal is a 2-member bench. I think last to last attempt. Appellate tribunal is a 2-member bench. They are fighting amongst themselves. One person is saying guilty, one person is saying not guilty about this particular case. So what to do? This they ask for 3 marks, 3 or 4 marks. So this is very simple. I have to send it to the chairperson of this AA. Chairperson and 2 members, I told you, no, 2 persons are only fighting. Send to the chairperson. The chairman will hear it and refer it to the other members of the appellate tribunal. So generally, I told you, AA will have chairperson plus 2 people. If the 2 people are fighting, then all the 3 will hear and then decide by majority, 2 out of 3. This they asked in the exam. This they asked in the exam. Okay. Then one more important question. Section 71 of PMLA says, this act will override, notwithstanding anything contained in any other law. Which means PMLA will override any other law, including IBC. On the other hand, section 238 says, IBC says, notwithstanding anything contained in any other law, this law will override that law. PMLA is telling I'll override IBC, IBC is telling I'll override PMLA. So that is the problem. And there have been cases where an asset confiscated under PMLA cannot form part of IBC liquidation estate. Any asset that you confiscated under PMLA cannot go to part of IBC liquidation estate. That's why one of the people also have asked here. A holding company is convicted under PMLA and proceeds of crime are invested in subsidiary company. Can the ED attach where subsidiary company is under CIRP? That's what I am saying. So here, that is PMLA versus IBC. So this has been amended for November examinations. So I am not going to talk about it. It has been amended for November examinations, not for July. It has been amended for November examinations, not for July. Nevertheless, for July people, you need to write this. First, you should say Section 71 overrides PMLA, overrides IBC. Then you should write 238, IBC overrides PMLA. Then you should say that in various case laws it was decided that an asset confiscated under PMLA cannot form of IBC liquidation estate. You cannot touch that. However, recent case, this is for our July 2020 fellows. Recent case, what they told? They told that both are parallel proceedings. Rotomac case, Vikram Kothari, Rotomac case, brilliant law it is. I had explained in my regular batch, 6D especially, we had discussed that in depth. So in the Rotomac case, what did they tell? That both are parallel proceedings. PMLA is one part of it, IBC, both should go hand in hand. Both should go hand in hand. You need to see that what will override what and then accordingly decide. So PMLA, Rotomac case, both are parallel proceedings. So one will not override the other. So under Section 71, PMLA may override IBC. Section 238, IBC may override PMLA. But an asset confiscated under PMLA cannot form part of the liquidation estate. And final conclusion, they found a balancing act in Rotomac case saying that do not touch the other. It is side by side. If the liquidator wants to touch a property which is confiscated, he has to go there and fight. Fight and get it out. So you cannot say this will override that and all that. To go fight and see, a balancing act has to be done. Okay. This is one more thing that they can ask in the exam. Then most important, release on bail. Very, very important section. Cognizable offense and non-bailable. Cognizable and non-bailable means what? Person can be arrested without warrant. Person under section 45 and under PMLA can be arrested without warrant and he will not get any bail. When I say non-bailable, doesn't mean actually non-bailable, bail etc. will be governed by the court. So anybody here accused of a PMLA offence, these are the rules. Public prosecutor should be given an opportunity to oppose. Public prosecutor should be given an opportunity to oppose the deal, and he opposes, but the court is satisfied that he is not guilty. So this is accused. The moment he is accused, the same provisions are there in SFIO, copy paste 212. Same provisions, SFIO. Anybody accused, mind you, this is against the Indian Constitution. Only when you are convicted, then you can see something. Here, when the moment you are accused, you have to prove you are not guilty initially only. This is against the principles of natural justice. This will be struck down, but for our exam, we have to still study this. Okay? There has been an amendment here also. I am not going to discuss that. So, a public prosecutor has been given an opportunity of opposing this, and he is opposes it also, but the court is satisfied that he is not guilty. Or remember this in SFIO we discuss, less than 16 years, or a woman, or a sick or infirm person. Then this amendment has come. Accused and others, if the money laundering amount is less than 1 crore, special court may grant bail. May grant bail. These three things you saw in SFIO. Less than 16 years, or woman, or sick or infirm. One additional point has come. Accused or others, money laundered is less than 1 crore. Money laundered is less than 1 crore. PONJ's principles of natural justice. So this we have successfully completed PMLA. All these are examination questions. Whatever we have discussed, did we understand? Yes or no? Right? These are examination questions. So guys, Corona has brought about hardship among our students. Many students are calling us and saying that, sir, you are charging 9,000 and all. Can you please reduce and all those things? And this RPL, because of this RPL, I have got to meet some wonderful faculty. Anyway, Durgesh sir was and I were associated before in our Advait Center in Bangalore, so where I run this academy here. And then through him, I got to know Tarun Raj sir, Prasanna Kumar sir, and Chinmay is my friend since more than 10 years. So we were college buddies. He was a different section. I was in the rowdy section. So we thought that we'll do something nice for the students. So one was, of course, the July guys. We are doing this RPL for you. So I hope it was of use, of some use at least. Then for November 20 and, you know, especially May 21 and all that, people have come to us and told, sir, money problem, there is some issue, we are not getting the required money and all that to sustain. Apparently the bosses also, principals also have reduced the stipend and all those things. It's very sad. So we thought that, okay, at least this is 2 minutes I'll take this information for your juniors. Please pass it on. For you guys, we are anyway doing this. But for the guys writing in November 20, May 21 and all those things, we thought, anyway, one very good information is we are coming out with the live classes, right, as an entire group. So now we call it as Team Exam Heist. This exam heist thing caught on like rapid fire, like wildfire. So we thought that we'll name the same thing, Team Exam Heist. And we will give, you know, the option of live batch, or it could be this thing also, PD or GD, whatever the case may be. So they said that, sir, every subject, if it is 10,000, 10,000, 10,000 and all, 30,000 and all, we cannot spend, sir, please do something. So we have formed this, you know, association sort of a thing, only for your benefit, friends. So you can pass it on. I just want to show this to you. So, and also I am associated with Aarti madam also. So if you see, this is the whole group one. Technically each subject 10, 10, 10, if you go, and ma'am, it's coming up to around 40,000 rupees. So FR will be taken by Chinmay sir, SFM Chinmay sir, I'll be handling paper 4 and ma'am will be handling this. So rather than doing this, there are two options. One is live. So the live interaction where you can interact with me, it will be like this. We have our own platform already ready. This will start from June 11. Okay, June 11. So the thing is, they are all coming and asking me what to do and all that. So this, friends, this entire combo of 40,000 Which actually costs 40,000, we are giving it to you at around 29,000 rupees, so 11,000 rupees is off. And the faculty are extremely good, Aarti madam, she is India's, one of the best India's faculty. This will be in the pen drive mode, but Chinmay sir and I will be coming live. Okay, so 29,000 are offering, so please pass on the information, just a request, please pass on the information to whoever is needed, whoever needs it. So if you see this also, yeah, this is, we are coming live. Live generally we charge around 9,000 friends, but then we thought, okay, leave it, we'll make it very less. So we are charging 6,999, and also if you want both the subjects also, it's actually cost 18,000. We are giving it to you at 13,000 live batch, live, where me and Chinmay sir will be there, you can talk to us. Chinmay sir will, this is for SFM, he's starting SFM, June 11, morning evening batch is happening. Please pass it on for your November 20 and May 21 friends, okay. This is one thing, one small information that I had to tell. And as far as group 2 is concerned also, we have made this team exam heist thing, online thing. So if you see each of the faculty, PK sir, Durgesh sir and indirect tax Tarun Raj sir are taking, with all books, everything included, they are taking a hit on their individual thing also. Everything we are giving at 8,000, 5,400 and 6,400, though it is 10,500 friends. However, overall also, group, second group, those three subjects, it actually cost 32,000, but we are giving it to at 19,800. This is a genuine thing that we have done because students are asking us kindly forward. And if you buy this combo also, the 6D paper, my paper, I'll give it at 3,500 or something, 3,999. Mine or even Durgesh's 6C, you can take it as 3,999, though it is around 5,000 or something. This is a genuine effort to help the students, nothing else. So we just decided that we've been getting so many, you know, things, all these things. So please spread the word. If you buy this 19,800, the 4,000 extra you paid, 23,000, you're also getting the paper 6D or 6C, whatever you want, you can take. This is only a part of the combo. Okay, so you can, if you want to, please pass on the message. You can, they can call our office, Advait Learning office, they can call. So I don't want to take much of your time doing this, but see, you guys only have to tell your juniors. We can't go and advertise it like a bang and all that, because we are giving it at very lesser rate. So I humbly request you to inform your juniors, correct? And anyway, for you guys, you have done the revision. I don't think so, you need to opt for any of these things. You aramse now study for July. That was our intention to give this. But during the course of exam heist, so many things, actually because of RPL, since a week we are getting this, sir, please do something, please do something. So it's fine. So whatever is costing 40,000, we are charging some 29,000, 11,000, it's fine, no problem. And second group also, it's costing 33,000, we are charging 19,800 plus 4,000 in this combo, you will also get 6D or 6C, okay. So 23,000 there and around 28,000 there. So at least rather than spending some 80,000, 90,000, you'll be spending around 40,000, 45,000. That was our idea, okay. So at least half. You are burdened. So we would want to reduce your burden little bit, okay. On that note, let us go ahead, friends. Let us go ahead. So please humbly request you to pass on the message to your buddies. Next, so you have requested me LODR, right? So let's do LODR and then I will do FCRA. The old syllabus guys can leave after that, okay. Yes, so coming to the LODR regulations, only the LODR part we will discuss, all the important regulations that are there. Let's go ahead, okay. Yes. Chinmay sir, risk management is not taking as of now, Kashish. Still it is in plans. He is also taking GFRS and all that. If you leave Chinmay sir, he'll take all subjects. That's why we are only controlling him. We are only doing, boss, you chill. You first, anyway, his, you know, plate is full now with SFM and FR. So he will eventually take it for sure, right? So if you see, holding company, independent, see, these are all the regulations, LODR regulations, right? So holding company's independent director should be a director of a unlisted material subsidiary. This is regulation number one. I'm not telling the number, I'm telling these are all the regulations. Don't go by the number and all that, but these are the important LODR regulations, okay. So the independent director of the holding company should be a director of the unlisted material subsidiary, unlisted material subsidiary, where the income or net worth is more than 20%. What is unlisted material subsidiary? Where the income or net worth is more than 20% of consolidated net worth of the holding company in the immediately preceding accounting year. That is the definition of unlisted material subsidiary. Is LODR applicable for old course? Yes, it is applicable for old course, new course, all course, correct? So it is important. That's why I didn't do SEBI. SEBI you can study. Okay, and FCRA also, now since there is no time, FCRA also have a plan for you. I have already released a video, 1 hour, where you can, it can fetch you 6 marks. So I'll give you that link, you can study that. This is for the new syllabus fellows. Do not miss FCRA, friends. New syllabus guys, do not miss FCRA. 6 marks in your pocket, because there have been at least 5-6 small amendments. Second, do not miss LODR regulations. Around 4 marks will come. SEBI anyways, 4 marks will come. Do not miss arbitration and conciliation. 3 marks will come. These two are for the new syllabus guys. Do not miss IBC, old and new, 10 marks. Correct? So if you see here, and PMLA, please do not miss, 4 to 6 marks. Here only if you see 14, then 18, 21, 26, over, no, what? ECB, Sir FEMA, 50 marks, 50 marks worth of amendment, chill. FEMA, aram se, 4 marks you will get, even if you don't get, leave it, I'm just saying. Because studying so much for just 4 marks, there's no point. This I will not tell for 6D paper. 6D fellows, please study FEMA, very, very important. Four, please study, but give it some equal importance. Don't give it first importance is what I'm saying. Smart, be smart. Smart studying is the order of the day, okay? Yes. So if you see, yeah, come on. So the independent director of the holding company will do what? Will have to be a director of an unlisted material subsidiary. What is this unlisted material subsidiary? Where the income or net worth is more than 20%, income or net worth is more than 20% of the consolidated net worth of holding company in the immediately preceding accounting year. So that is one part of it you have to do. Second part of it was you have to report all significant transactions. For example, purchase of land and all those things. Point number one is this regulation. Independent director should be the director here. Point number two, I have to report significant transaction, that is purchase of land, etc. What is significant transaction? Any transaction which is more than 10% of the total liability, total revenue, total assets or total expenses of the unlisted material subsidiary. That is what they defined in the immediately preceding accounting year. So one is, what is unlisted material subsidiary? Income or net worth more than 20% of the consolidated net worth. And second one, I have to report significant transaction. Significant transaction. What should you do? More than 10% of the total liability, total revenue, total assets and total expenses of the unlisted material subsidiary in the immediately preceding accounting year. Got it? So this is one part of it that you need to memorize, maybe in MCQ or directly they can ask you this particular question. Next, coming to this, if I am a holding company, right, and I am divesting, means what? Selling shares. Divestment is the opposite of investment. Divestment is the opposite of investment. Holding company, I am divesting shares. Overall, how much? Less than, so that the overall shareholding comes below 51%. So I am a holding company, holding let's say 60% or something. Now I am divesting 11% shares, such a manner that my overall shareholding is coming below 50%. Then if you see, I have to pass a special resolution. Unless this is a scheme of arrangement already approved under 230 and 231. If this is a scheme of compromise and arrangement, then no need. But if it is a simple divestment route where I'm selling off my stake in a particular company, then what happens? Special resolution has to be passed. This is the second part. I'm not saying this is a second regulation. These are the important regulations that you have to remember. Okay. And mind you, friends, here it says significant transactions, right? Correct. Of what? The unlisted material subsidiary is what I need to take. And if you see here, unlisted material subsidiary definition I also have understood. So it is similar to sort of 180, 1A of Companies Act. So those who want to compare, you can compare. Now I don't have the time to sit and explain this. But those who remember 181A, talking about selling of undertaking, their undertaking is different, net worth and total income. Here undertaking is assets and not undertaking. Okay, it's not about undertaking, but it's about the assets here. Anyway, now coming to the quarterly compliances. Quarterly compliances. This bloody chapter is actually for company secretaries. Why? Because they have to comply with these provisions. It beats me that why we should know all these quarterly compliances. It's more of memory than anything else, honestly speaking. So ICDR regulations were amazing. They have removed ICDR and put LODR. ICDR was very good, extremely, you know, excellent. Now, there's a grievance redressal mechanism. A grievance redressal mechanism. Like, if any shareholder comes with a grievance, you need to redress it. You need to address that particular grievance. When? That entire report should be given 21 days from the end of each quarter. 21 days from the end of each quarter. So what? How many were received? How many were disposed of? How many are unresolved? Everything you should give it to the SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India. These regulations are the regulations that has to be taken by the legal team. The legal team has to take up these things and file it with the Security Exchange Board of India. Okay. So one is the grievance redressal mechanism within 21 days. Other corporate governance. When China tried to buy 1% of HDFC, were these regulations applied? Yes, they were applied. So other corporate governance mechanisms, again, 15 days from the close of the quarter. 15 days from the close of the quarter, you need to, all other things apart from this, apart from grievance redressal, other things should go 15 days from the close of the quarter. Shareholding pattern of the company, how many people are holding shares and each person is holding how many shares. So one day before listing of securities, I need to give. One more is 21 days from the end of each quarter I should give, and then within 10 days of capital restructuring. What do you mean by capital restructuring? Where there is a change of more than 2% POC. In this structure you understand, one day before listing of securities, give the shareholding pattern if I am going for listing, IPO. In other case, every time after it's listed, 21 days from the end of each quarter, and within 10 days from capital restructuring. What do you mean by capital restructuring? Any change in the capital more than 2%, where someone else has taken over your shares. That is the scene. Financial results of the company. When we should declare the financial results? Days from the end of first, second and third quarter. Why fourth quarter is not there? That anyway will go as per the annual report, no? Audited financial statement will go. So fourth quarter, that provision will be there only. So this one, 45 days from the end of the quarter, you need to file this first, second and third quarter. And any statement of any deviations in terms of public issue, right issue and preferential issue, should any deviation in what sense? That whether I have used the proceeds of that particular thing for something else, or whether the proceeds have been used for the particular purpose for which I went for a right issue. All these things. If you saw recently, Reliance went for a right issue, they have given the entire logic. It's an all cash deal. Just like Facebook took over, it's an all cash deal. One of the objectives, if you see the, in the what do you say, invitation to offer letter, that is the right entitlement letter, you will see the object is to, for our Reliance to become debt free in the next couple of years. They want to pay off all their debts and want to become a debt-free company. Now, use of proceeds, that is objects versus actual and explanatory statement, and I have to give a category-wise variation. Category-wise variation of the projected and the actual utilization of the entire thing. So this is what, friends, quarterly compliance of the stock exchange. Then comes the other one, prior intimation. Only have to remember these lines, what to do, prior intimation. Financial results must be intimated under Regulation 29 5 days before the actual, you know, date of the meeting. So the date of the meeting and date of intimation also should be added. So it's 5 plus 2. Before the meeting, the financial result should be intimated to whom? SEBI. That's the first thing. Other matters should be done within 2 working days. So here working days is not given. Here working days is given. Between 2 working days before the meeting where the following is discussed, with respect to dividend, bonus, issue of securities, buyback, right issue and all these cases. 2 working days before only, where before the meeting where it is going to be discussed, that intimation I have to give it to the stock exchanges, because these are all very, very price sensitive information. That is why I need to keep that in mind. In special cases, regulation 29. What are the special cases? Redemption amount, payment of redemption amount, redemption of preferences, debentures, bonds, etc. That I should tell 11 working days before. Correct? 11 days before where I am redeeming the bonds and debentures, I need to tell them. Tell them means whom? The SEBI. What do you mean by record date? They will obviously fix a date. On that date, whoever are the members, they will get the offer. So your Reliance, for that matter, they also fixed a record date. They said on this date, let's say it was some 25th May. On 25th May, whoever are the members of Reliance, for them, as on that date, they will get the right share entitlement. They will get the right share entitlement. So 7 working days is what they are trying to tell. So record date should be what? 7 working days from the date of closure of the transfer books. Date of closure of the transfer books. So you will close the books of accounts for a certain period during all these things. During the right entitlement also, they close the books for a certain period. That also has to be intimated to SEBI. If I am declaring any dividend, etc., I am recommending dividend, declaring dividend, giving any cash bonus, that has to be declared 5 working days before the record date. 5 working days before the record date. Correct? That is what it says. Then regulation 46, website. Website should be done what? 2 working days from the date of change. If you make any changes in the website, some important changes, within 2 days from the date of the, you know, change, you need to give it to the, send a report to whom? SEBI. These are the things. Then apart from that, this will all help you in your cure, this thing, what do you say, MCQ. Quarterly compliance. This is regarding related party transactions, section 188, quarterly compliances. Quarterly, 15 days from the end of the quarter, you need to give a quarterly related party transaction report. Half yearly compliance, once in 6 months, 30 days from the date of publication of half year standalone results you should give. Yearly compliance, 6 months from the end of financial year. Correct? So these are the days. See guys, these days they don't have any logic. You have to mug these up. I am not kidding. These days can change tomorrow. Regulations can say 20 days. So this, there is absolutely no logic to it. What I am trying to do is you have to remember the days. 15 days, 30 days. That's why I kind of hate this chapter, because this, the CA should be more of a, you know, memory technician rather than understanding the logic. So that's why I find this chapter to be a little absurd in the larger scheme of things when it comes to the law. Okay, next. Yearly compliance, on the other hand. Yearly compliances. Financial results within 60 days from the end of the financial year. This anyway you will do, na? 60 days from the end of the financial year. From the 60 days from the end of the AGM, anyway you will file. Within 30 days you will file the financial, statements under 137. Within 60 days of the AGM, you will file the annual return anyway. Apart from that, this within 60 days from the end of financial year, not the AGM year. 60 days from the end of financial year, you obviously need to file the financial results also. And half yearly should be 45 days from the end of each half year. Annual report, that is 21 working days from the date of adoption or approval. That is under AGM route. Adoption or approval, 21 days. Annual report is the final report which has all the documents. 21 working days from the date of adoption plus approval. So what is the scene here, friends? The entire scheme of things, how does it happen? I'm sure you know. So one is your balance sheet date, right? Then after that, what happens? Approval of the board of directors under 134.1. Approval. After approval, what happens? They will sign on it. Authentication. They will sign authentication. After authentication, they will give it to the auditor for his report thereon. Then what happens? Audit report will come. Audit report will come under which section? 143.2. After the audit report is given, this also you have to follow that SA, SA 700, 701 and all those things, 705, 706. This is your audit report. After audit report, what happens? Board report will come. Because under 134.3F, The board has to report on the adverse comments made by the auditor. Correct? Then what happens? The auditor will again check the board report and he will check for material inconsistencies. Auditing also is my favorite subject along with law. So all this, it's nice. This is what? Essay 720. Other information in the audit of financial statements, right? So first is what? Balance sheet, then 134(1) approval, then what happens? 134(1) authentication, then audit report, board report, auditor will report on the board report, correct? Then what happens? Then it will be circulated. How will you circulate? Section 136. All the documents will be circulated. What all documents will be circulated? Your financial statements, right? Then auditor's report, then board report, then all the notes to accounts. This you can find it in this, circulation of documents. Before that, you will also see 134(7) and then read with 136, right? Then after that, what happens after circulation? Then you will lay it before the shareholders. Laying of financial statements. Laying of the financial statement. This is given in your 129(2). The financial statements will be laid. And at the financial statements, when they are laying, what happens here? Here at the AGM, adoption does not happen, friends. Adoption does not happen. If you see the 102 subsection 2, clause A, subclause 2, it is called consideration of accounts. Sorry, clause subclause 1. Consideration of accounts. They will just consider it, that's all. Then after consideration, they may go for what? Either adoption or unadopted financial statements also have to be filed. Both are covered within 30 days of AGM. This is under which route? This thing, 137 section. This is nothing but my MG. Sorry, this is 30 days of AGM. So this annual return will be filed in one form. This, of course, MGT 7 and AOC 4. We anyway use it now. That's the thing. 30 days of AGM you do. Now, why I am doing all these things is that entire thing that you do is called annual report. Annual report. Correct? Where will you find, this is ULTA forms, okay, where will you file the annual report? How will you file? This is for your listed companies. How will you file? That is given here. Check it out. 21 working days from the date of adoption or approval, AGM or adjourned AGM. That's the thing. See, adoption or approval, the AGM or adjourned AGM. Within this 21 days, I have to file this annual report. Did you get it? 21 working days from the date of adoption or approval. Adoption or approval. And other documents and information to be sent to shareholders 21 days before every AGM. This is what they see. This is the scene. Apart from that, what are the other things? Other issues with respect to thing that you leave. That's fine. So, yeah, coming to the private placement. So, anything with respect to private placement and all that are special things, right? Special things. Here, if you see, we discussed the special items here. Where did it go? Other matters. All these other matters with respect to private placement and all those things. That has to come here. So, what do you mean by private placement? Private placement can be divided into three parts. One is preferential allotment. This is 62(1)(c). Private placement is covered in section 42 of the Companies Act. QIP, Qualified Institutional Placement Program. Qualified Institutional Placement Program. And IPP is Institutional Placement Program. These are all part of the ICDR regulations before. So it may be out of your syllabus, but you should know these terms because they are linked to these things. They can ask you, if I do a QIP, what will happen? So preferential allotment is given to the individuals. Preferential allotment is given to the individuals. It is again one type of private placement. But if you follow the provisions of section 42, then section 42 will come. Otherwise, no, that is one part of it. QIP is giving into the big shots. And the big shots are called qualified institutional buyers. This is also a form of private placement. Rather than giving it to individuals, I will give it to the big shots, mutual fund units and all the mutual fund houses. That is called QIB, qualified institutional buyers. Now, as per SCRA, certain companies have to maintain certain minimum shareholding, right? So if, let's say, steel industry, I'm just giving you an example, should maintain public shareholding of 55%, promoter shareholding, let's say, 45%. Now, if the promoter is, let's say, holding 50%, now he has to dilute that 5% and give it to the public, correct? Obviously. So that it becomes 55 and 45. Now, again, rather than giving it to the public means individual, public can be QIB also. So to maintain the SCRA guideline, if I sell off my share, 5% for example, to a QIB, that is called as a IPP, Institutional Placement Program. Institutional Placement Program, that is giving it to QIB, but to attain the minimum public shareholding. Then what happens? This particular thing happens, private placement, that is the scene. Now, there are various committees and all that you have to form under this, but this thing, what are the committees? See, these four things are also important. One is what? Audit committee, nomination and remuneration committee, stakeholder relationship committee, then risk management committee, right? Audit committee, minimum three directors must be there, same as Companies Act section 177. Two-third of them must be independent directors, whereas in section 177 Companies Act, it is majority. Remember, we solved one integrated MCQ. There we saw majority we had to take. Three independent directors were there, so two out of three. That is following SEBI also, because two-third here are independent directors. Next, one member to have accounts or financial management expertise. So he should be an expert in accounts and financial management. Chairman should always be an independent director. These are all SEBI guidelines. And they have to meet four times a year. Gap between two meetings should be maximum 120 days. Gap between two meetings, 120 days. This is not your board meeting. These are separate independent directors ka meeting, audit committee meeting, right? Then quorum. Quorum is what? Quorum of the Normal Companies Act is what? One-third and all that. Here it also is one-third or two, whichever is higher, with minimum two independent directors. This is one part of it. As far as the NRC, that is, NRC is not the other NRC, correct? National Registry of Citizens, don't go there. This is the Nomination and Remuneration Committee. So this is formed under section 178, and also it's there in the SEBI guidelines to fix the remuneration for the directors, especially the MD, whole-time director and all those things. So if you see, minimum three directors, same as 178, all directors in the committee must be non-executive in nature. Means none of them should be working full-time in the company. So half of them should be independent directors. Chairman of the company cannot be the chairman of the Nomination and Remuneration Committee. However, if the chairman happens to be a non-executive director, he can definitely become a member of the committee, but not the chairman. New chairman, if you are appointing now, this was in the old law, new regulation says he has to be an independent director without a doubt. Quorum is again two or one-third, whichever is higher. At least one independent director must be there. In audit committee, two independent directors. In this, at least one independent director must be there. And they should meet at least once a year. That is the scene with respect to Nomination and Remuneration Committee. Stakeholder Relationship Committee. This is to ensure that all the stakeholders are protected, be it shareholders, or banks, or creditors, everybody. Stakeholder Relationship Committee. It is same as the Companies Act, no change, and the chairman happens to be a non-executive director. Chairman happens to be a, should be a non-executive director. Three directors are included, including one independent director must be there, minimum three directors including one independent director. These fellows should meet at least once a year. This is what the Stakeholder Relationship Committee says all about. Risk Management Committee, RMC, Risk Management Committee, top 500 listed company as per market capitalization should have a Risk Management Committee. Classic example is Nokia. The CEO of Nokia was telling when they were closing down that the only change that we had to do was to change. So they had this entire superiority complex saying that they are invincible, nobody can touch them because they are what? Your big shots. So when the Android platform came, they, you know, sort of did not pay heed to the importance of Android. So they said that more than 98% of the world uses Windows. Remaining 2% sell their kidneys, you know what I mean. So 98% of them uses Windows anyway. So they say, no, their market share is so much that time. So they said, no, I'll use Windows platform. So Windows platform where work for a PC, but for a normal phone, it was very, very bad, the Windows platform. So eventually Android was slowly being rapidly, you know, sort of being adopted since it was open source in nature by various companies and various, you know, phone manufacturers. Nokia lost the bus, missed the bus. And in fact, they were given the first opportunity and they were completely wiped out from the market. So like that, to ensure that you are not technologically obsolete, you need to have a Risk Management Committee. You should have a Risk Management Committee, right? Yes. So if you see, that is the scene. Please don't insult Apple users. I'm not insulting, man. You sell kidney, I sell pancreas. I have to buy one phone, so I have to sell my pancreas. Small, small items will be there. No, appendix and all I sell. Correct? I have already lost one kidney because even I have an iPad. So one kidney is gone. Other kidney I will not use. That's the thing. So if you see top 500 listed company as per market capitalization, majority of the members must be board of directors. Correct? Majority of the members must be the board of directors here in the Risk Management Committee, because here the main board is deciding, right, as to what is technologically obsolete, what is there and all those things. So if you see 500 listed companies as per market cap is one, majority of the members should be board of directors is what they say. Chairman of the RMC, that is Risk Management Committee, chairman of the Risk Management Committee should be a member of the board. Chairman of the Risk Management Committee should be a member of the board, and they should meet at least once a year. They should meet at least once a year. So that is the scene. Then coming to insider trading, we need to understand what is insider trading. This also they keep asking in the examination. Right. So if you see, no insider shall indulge in insider trading. So what do you mean by an insider? Any connected person. So take an example where my friend recently, he is working in one of the big fours. So we came the big or one of the you know, consultancy wing, for example. And let's say we were having breakfast and he just told me, let's say Infosys shares are going to increase in the next 7 months because I'm working on a mergers and amalgamation M&A deal. Infosys is going to buy out 2-3 companies. So you please invest now. It's going to hike up later. Randomly over breakfast, he told me. I am not into investment. I told my friend who just listened to it casually, and he told his wife. Now wife's friend was into investing. So the wife's friend told it to that, obviously, the friend who actually bought the shares of Infosys. Is this insider trading? 100% yes. Because it is what? Connected person, deemed connected person. And that connected person or person has reasonably, he has expected to know what? Has received what? UPSI. Unpublished price sensitive information. UPSI means unpublished price sensitive information. So definitely he has UPSI, unpublished price sensitive information, correct? So that is the scene. He has unpublished price sensitive information. So that is the reason Why? What is this? If published, this information will become very, very important. That's the reason why it's unpublished now, because it will change the way market forces will play. Who is a connected person? It can be a director, officer, employee, or any person who has a business relationship. What did I tell? My friend had a business relationship because he was working in the M&A division, correct? So UPSI, that is, has access, reasonable access to unpublished price sensitive information. Now this, if I use, right, gone. Because using this, if I do what? Directly or indirectly do what? Deal in securities or communicate, counsel or procure information. My friend communicated to me, I communicated to somebody else, I counseled somebody else, and the other person procured the information. All of us will be liable. All of us will be liable under insider trading. So the insider trading is the next norm. So with this we complete. Guys, for FCRA, I'll give you a better idea. Rather than me doing the same thing again, please go to Advait Learning channel and just type FCRA. 1 hour, less than 1 hour, 6 marks guaranteed. Please read those of your new syllabus, check it out, okay? Because that will help you. Rather than me doing the same thing again, I've explained everything in a gist there. Same using chart methodology. That's why you please go there. It's less than 1 hour. It will really help you. All the amendments are covered there. So go to my channel, Advait Learning, and do it. All right, guys. With this, I think we have come to an end to our association, now limited association, for around 10 days. I had superb fun every single day. You guys were there with me, correct? You guys were there. And you always, you know, sort of encouraged me to sort of take classes, asking doubts, having fun here. That's the thing. So really, it is very, very important, correct? For me also, it was very important for me also to interact with you. And honestly, thank you from the bottom of my heart for giving us an opportunity, the entire association. We are going to do something amazing in the days to come. Stay tuned, because now we found like-minded individuals who are not too much into making money. Money is secondary, friends, but money is needed for our livelihood. I mean, obviously, we are not a charitable organization, but I always wanted a group of people who always think like me and Chinmay sir, in terms of, you know, giving discounts or helping out students and all that. So now we have a like-minded bunch of people. And along with Aarti madam also, who are of the same mindset, and we are going to do something really good for our students. So this July 2020 RPL was one idea where we really wanted to sort of help the students. Because of Corona, people were complaining, and people had completely, students had completely gone into depression. So we really wanted to uplift them by actually coming live here. Whatever is possible. Only one day I could not come because of other reasons, but every single day I was here interacting with all of you. So it was been such an amazing thing for me as well. So thank you so much. So tomorrow onwards, I obviously will not be coming here live because other faculty will take over. Please attend those classes also. It will help you. And from the bottom of my heart, all the very best. I just give me one thing in return. This also may be a contract, though there is no consideration, no contract, it's fine. This is a contract between me and you, and I want something in return. Very, very simple. 2 letters before your name. You have been struggling, especially people who are writing this July examination. They are under tremendous pressure because I understand you have studied everything, but exam is getting postponed. Again, studying everything, exam is getting postponed. It is very, very annoying. Plus, you also have this corona thing. Sort of around you, where you can't even study at peace. But despite that, every single day around 50-60 people are coming here and doing all these things and encouraging us also to interact with you. So each and every one person I want to thank here. Kashesh, Nikhil, Ramani, Sinduja, Hemal, Kritika, Melita, George, Kashesh, Alvin, Tom, Rangesh, Denny Johnson, Ramani, Komal, Rangesh. So thank you so much. So it was really amazing interacting with all. I'm sorry if I missed somebody, whoever has written recently, I've written. And many of you have come, been a part of this very nice, small, you know, 10-day thing. This exam heist thing we are going to do almost every time now. It has been decided, right? Inter-fellows are now crying. Sir, cheating, only seniors and all you are doing. So for inter-fellows also, we are trying something. So this is a genuine effort from like-minded people. to come and help you in our own small way, right? Because the only difference between me and you is I have those two letters before my name. And I also want you to get those two letters before your name and come to this side so that we can help our friends. We should always remember that once upon a time we were also article clerks, we were also students. We should never forget that. Some of the faculties I've seen unfortunately have that audacity that once they become teachers, they don't, you know, think about the students. Ultimately, it's the students who give the 3 meals a day and a roof over our head. We should never forget that. Having said that, it obviously should not be like a charitable thing. We also have to live, but we cannot overcharge. So that is the objective of this association. So request you to kindly spread the word to your friends and all that to avail the offer if need be. But for you guys, especially for you, all the very best, okay? So stay in touch. My law channel is there. You can stay in touch with me. There may be delays in responding, but I'll definitely reply, right? So I'm there with you guys. All the very best. Take care. Good night. Thank you so much. I had fun. I hope you had too. All the very best, guys. All the best. So please attend the rest of the RPL session. Some amazing faculty coming up. Chinmay sir, Prasanna Kumar sir, and all that. Please attend. Durgesh sir, me and Tarun Raj sir have finished. So the others are coming up. Please take care and please attend. All the best.